The history of neuroscience has been really trying to define the types of cells that make up the brain. The challenge is that this complexity and diversity of types has made it extremely difficult for any individual effort to be able to really quantitatively define what the different types of cells are.
Defining cell types is actually one of the most fundamental neuroscience questions. In order to translate what we have learned, for example, from the mouse, to the understanding of how cells in the human brain works, we need that critical information regarding what cell types are similar or conserved and what are different.
In this current work with the BICCN, it's not so much about function yet. It's about characterization or classification. We now can profile cells at a level that 10 years ago we couldn't do.
The human brain and how it works is one of the greatest mysteries that faces humankind today. It's as complex as understanding the cosmos, literally. So what we've done here is we've leveraged expertise from many, many different domains and really come together to invent new ways of integrating this information to give us a new view of what the brain is made up of and what are the principles, the organizational principles for this incredibly complex organ.
The choice of primary motor cortex was based on several criteria. All mammals have a primary motor cortex responsible for voluntary motor control. And by picking that region, we were really comparing apples to apples across species. A key result is that we were able to do this same classification effort in mouse and in monkey and in human, and then to align these across species to see just how similar this cellular makeup is. And the key result is that there really are no major branches of new types of cells that have arisen from a mouse to a human. At the same time, at the finest granularity of subdivisions of types of cells, you start to see some significant differences between the species. And so we have a basic, highly conserved blueprint. For example, all mammals have forelimbs, and yet a mouse and a dolphin and a human have very different looking forelimbs. And so this is the same sort of thing that we're now seeing at the level of cell types, that we have the basic cellular organization, but they can become very specialized to be quite functionally distinct in different species. One of the examples of this are the so-called BET cells, which we were able to characterize in this study. They're the neurons in the deeper part of the cortex that connect to the spinal cord. These cells are extremely large. They have very different firing properties compared to a mouse, where we don't even use that term. But we were able to show, using this homology based on genes, that the same type of general cell exists across species. And this is really the name of the game here, that we have overall homology and then specialization in the features.
What this particular study has given us insight about is not only what makes us the same, but also what are the key differences. And by understanding both the commonalities and differences, that really allows us to generate better models for human disease, more effective ones that can actually translate into cures. If we can combine and integrate all these different paths of information, know-how, expertise, I think we have a chance of curing what used to be or still are hopeless diseases within our generation.
All these technologies certainly have come to a point where it made such a profiling effort feasible. You know, brain science is moved much more closer to the way the genomics world works. It's both big technology, big data, and big collaboration.
This is very rare in research. There are only a few major efforts like this in history. I feel extremely fortunate to be able to work on this problem. It really opened up our eyes about how diverse the cells are, you know, how capable they are in doing different kinds of things.
I think this project, frankly, has exceeded expectations. The amount of information we've gotten, the approaches that we've developed, and the new principles we've uncovered have been really quite amazing. But that's not to say we need to rest on that. We have come a long way, but there's still many mysteries of the brain that we really are in the same dark cave as we were 5 years ago, but now we actually have a way to figure it out. So this is what, to me, is quite exciting. Our work is definitely cut out for us, but I'm really quite enthusiastic that the best is still yet to come.